everybody, to the March 8th meeting of the Hadley Select Board. And this evening, during budget season, again, we're starting at 6:30 because we're doing departmental budget reviews. And tonight, we are going to start with the Department of Public Works. And we have with us our Director, Marla Warner. Good evening.
Good evening. So if it pleases the board, I will go through the major changes of each budget. If there's any questions at the end of each budget, absolutely ask on another account number. But I'll hit the main bullets on them. The past year, I've been here a year. I've been kind of evaluating the department and trying to see where needs are, where we may be short, we may be heavy. Evaluate the processes. So when I built this budget, I had a few things that I had come across that I think if we move a few of the pieces around, we'll be more efficient in what we do in the DPW. So the first budget, the general budget for highway. Starting with the salaries, we have in overall for actual salaries, there's an increase of approximately $13,505 for the raises. And under that, the new position that we had instituted when the superintendent had retired under the new title field superintendent, there's a decrease of approximately $10,500 in that line item. So overall, the salaries went up about $2,000 with the increases for next year.
And Marla, just to clarify, when you say increases for next year, these are the union?
Collective bargaining agreement, and also clerical is figured in there. Also, the overtime line item needed to be increased the same proportion as the salaries to follow the CBA, collective bargaining agreement. The next account that I would like to talk about is the engineering services, 5302. I had submitted for 5250 and admin decrease at 1,000. I'd like to remain at the 5250 if possible. Due to commitments to the COG highway commitments we have for bidding materials for highway. We have to pay a fee for that.
Who took the 1,000 out of there? Was it David?
Yes.
Why'd you do that?
A couple of reasons. One, I was trying to take pressure off the school budget cuts that I made to them, recommended cuts that I made to their increase, I should say. The other thing is I looked over the historical use of that line item, and it seemed like the cut of $1,000 would keep us within the historical trend. Now, the information concerning the regional procurement is new information that has arisen since preparing this back in February.
And the impact of that new information would be?
Would be that we would have to pay, what is it, $3,500?
$3,200 in four increments throughout the year.
Yeah.
Four bills.
For what?
For regional procurement of materials.
Yes.
What do we pay now?
Well, that's all.
The information, what we pay now is a fee that's passed through on the materials itself, and doing an analysis, it appears that we're paying many times more than $3,200 per year for regional purchasing through the HCOG. So it's a different structure for the fees, but I think that it's a better buy for the town.
I'm guessing that affects the numbers we looked at last week from the HCOG.
Yes, it does.
Well, there's no way around that. The biggest item we have is the bituminous concrete for paving. Every year we get it from them, and that's the big number.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
But I was looking at last week when we were talking about a benefit from using the HCOG at $3,200 a year is one thing. At $12,000 or $13,000 a year is significantly different. And if we're saving $27,000 and we didn't equate the $13,000, we equated only $3,200, that affects my decisions on what we do with the COG significantly.
Point of interest, Jerry, this morning I went in to see David and I asked him to put it on the agenda for next week for further discussion about the COG.
Okay.
Because I'm looking for some direction to March 23rd for the meeting, mm-hmm. that we're having a full board.
Right, because that's its own conversation.
Yes, right. It is. But I'm looking for some direction from this board of how we should react to the situations that are happening there.
Okay, good.
So at your last meeting, you had the town administrator for Belcher Town come in and talk about how you should examine the numbers a little bit more carefully. So fair enough, we did that work, and we realized that we had an opportunity for a better deal through another regional purchasing program than staying with the HCOG for DPW supplies.
So can I just ask, so just again, sticking to the task at hand.
Yeah.
If in fact we're getting a better deal on the supplies, where are the supplies on here in this budget? And would there be a corresponding
reduction?
A lot of that would be paid through Chapter 90, so it would be off budget.
So it's not part of the budget, right? I mean, right. Yeah, it's real money, yeah, but it's not part of the budget.
Part of the paving program that we get reimbursed from Chapter 90, and a COG does all the bidding for us,
yep.
so that we don't have to go through all the procurement process on each item that we, in the paving program, that are your high dollar items.
Mm-hmm.
So.
What's the difference in the numbers? Let's talk about that for a minute. What are we looking at saving versus what we're paying now? It's per ton, I assume.
According to this, last year you said 3,100 and something. The savings was $21,364.65, roughly.
I believe that's assumed
last week.
Okay, that's from yeah. the HCOG.
That's for all purchases.
That's for all purchases.
Well, yeah, not just highway. I don't believe that's all purchases.
Well, yeah, it says municipality $571,216 for the total purchase. So.
And the bulk of that is the highway stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you get about $350,000 annually, and some years that changes, but mm-hmm. around $350,000 annually through Chapter 90. It's about half of what we need in order to keep the roads in condition over the long run. So every time we have an opportunity to stretch a Chapter 90 dollar by providing more material, more service, we should take that opportunity.
One COG's going to offer you X per ton. Another COG is going to offer you Y per ton. What's the difference between the two?
Well, we're out to bid right now, so we don't know that answer right now. But just doing a backup of the envelope calculation, Marlo and I sat down, and I think the savings just on the administrative fees are going to be significant.
Okay, but the impact on this budget, so you're asking for the $1,000 to go back in.
Right.
And are you now concurring with that based on?
Yeah, I have no objection.
Okay.
And if you remember last week, you reduced the legal budget by $5,000, so you have the capacity to add $1,000 back in.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. That's okay. Playing the heart now.
Yeah, normally, isn't it? Shut that off. Yeah. Somebody looking for money, I'm sure.
So the gasoline budget also was $2,000 was taken out by David, and I just wanted to put out that right now we're running at 81%. It's been more like a real winter, so the fuel use has been more in line of where it should be in an average year. It fluctuates, it's very volatile. So I was going to request that I'm at 81% already, and if we get any normal winters going forward, we're going to be right up there at the $55,700, and I was going to request that could be put back in also.
Wouldn't most of that be included in your snow and ice budget when you run over the amount of money that was allocated? Wouldn't you include portions of that for gasoline?
I don't think you can run the gasoline into that.
Not at all?
No.
Okay.
Small increase in road paint markings. There's quite a few signs out there that or they don't reflect anymore, if you will. So we want to kind of start chipping away at them and replacing a few of our signs. There's been a little bit added line painting. Some of the roads are wide enough for double yellow where there's a single yellow line. I'd like to double up on them. That meets the uniform code. Uniforms is also a CBA increase, collective bargaining agreement. The overall total highway budget is a minus 0.12% when you get to the end of it. I think that's the one thing I wanted to point out with all the moving parts of what's happening here with the staff and the other items, that it's, again, minus 0.12% for overall budget.
But it's been changed if we add these numbers back in.
Yes. It would actually be a 0.04% increase for the $3,000.
When you're painting the lines, Marlo, it's the yellow lines are off of the center line, so many feet?
Yes.
So can we do anything to help accommodate the bicycles on Route 47? It's become a designated bike area now from Sunderland all the way to South Hadley. And when they only have a little bit to work in, it becomes very, dangerous for the bicycles and the vehicle traffic, but maybe we don't have the room to work with.
There's areas of 47 where it would work. There's also most areas that it won't. If I'm remembering the dimensions properly, you need 24 feet just for your two travel lanes. Mm-hmm. So if you have a 28-foot road or a 30-foot road, you can get away with a 3-foot bicycle lane on each side. But when you're at 24 feet, you have to have a 12-foot. If we narrow them any further, we're going to have problems with the actual vehicle travel. Right.
So then probably we can do it in the reconstructed areas. Right. That were widened out for drainage and things of right. that nature.
An example is up above North Maple before it turns to Roosevelt. That's really wide there, mm-hmm. beyond Mount Warner.
Yep.
There's no reason why we can't, when we repaint next spring, if they're faded enough, or black out the lines that are there, to put bike lane assistance in there, because mm-hmm. it's plenty wide enough to accommodate both lanes of travel also.
And does the state, just to follow up on Donald's question, on Route 47, does the state have any jurisdiction / obligation relative to painting?
No.
They're good enough to have taken that Russellville culvert project and put it on their TIF.
Yeah.
And that's a $900,000 savings to the town of Hadley, so I'm very grateful for that.
So we don't push the...
Well, not so much that is that they don't have an obligation to us. It's a state numbered highway, but it's our road to maintain.
Okay. So anything else on highway worthy of note? So the overall, so actually a very slight decrease overall in the budget.
0.04 up.
Correct, with the 3,000
pullback. How many summer hires are you
going to
do?
I was looking at the numbers for the temporary help in all the divisions, and it looks like we can probably do one if we need to.
Mm-hmm.
Something I can present on a later date.
Okay.
It's a good program. Local Hadley student.
Yep.
Fight night.
Yeah. Okay.
Any other questions for Marlo on highway?
Good.
Finance committee, any questions now? You ready to roll into the other?
I do have just one question.
Sure.
So the increase for the road paint, do you foresee that going back next year? Like if you're going to increase it by $1,750, so next year, is this a one-time thing?
No, because you're increasing what you're using for amount of paint each year. You're going to double lines.
Oh.
It's also a bid item, somewhere around 0.04 cents per linear foot. So once we go to the double lines, we're going to have to continue to maintain them.
Okay.
That portion is probably approximately like $700 of the increase. The rest would be working on signage, proper signage.
Okay. So moving on.
I guess we'll go to snow and ice.
Page 64 in the book. Anybody following along?
The snow and ice budget, I'm not sure the last time that it was increased, but going back to FY14, I was seeing a lot of the same numbers on the supplies. I know in about a five-year span, salt has gone up significantly. And also, under the CBA agreement, I bumped the overtime wages a little bit, 3.5%. And I did increase the snow supply, salt and sand to an even 100,000 from 88,399.
What are you running at this year?
Excuse me?
What are you running at this year? What's your numbers this year?
I'm running right as the existing budget, right about zero right now.
How much was it? The budget was?
The overall
budget. 88,000?
168.
Mm-hmm. Marla, just that, sorry, my memory escapes me. The collective bargaining, is the 3.5% the increase for the calendar year for collective bargaining?
Correct, yeah. And I have to apply that to all the overtime wages.
Okay.
So, yes, at 168,222, we're right about zero, Jerry, on this year's budget. Right now.
I'm sorry, what are you asking?
The
1 year collective bargaining for DPW?
No, everybody's on a 3 year.
3 year.
Right, but it's not.
So it's not 3.5 this year?
It's not 3.5%.
No, I was asking, so you increased it 3.5%, but that doesn't equate to their 1 year contractual percentage increase in pay, correct? For 1 year. Because that's all we'd be looking at.
The overall three-year increase might be that number, but
I thought it was
annually
only
1 or
1.5.
Yeah, that's not the 3.5% for pay increase.
So the collective bargaining agreement that we settled for DPW is a 0% COLA, but it's add a step, drop a step. Each step interval is 3.5%.
Oh, okay. All right.
Okay,
I'm thinking COLA. Yeah.
Right,
it's not
right.
A COLA.
It's not
right.
A COLA.
Not
a
COLA.
Yes.
No,
that's
it's
okay. It's not yours. Right. So it is 3.5.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it is the third year of the three-year agreement
right.
We're going
right.
into.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Any questions on snow and ice?
We need to disclose the import of the increase that we're requesting for snow and ice. I fully support the budget that's being proposed. If you look back at 2015 when we had a tough winter,
mm-hmm.
you see that our total usage was $211,000,
mm-hmm.
Dollars, which was far above the appropriation of 168 that we originally started out with. Back in 2015, in 2016, we had a very mild winter. In 2017, who knows? We're not out of winter yet.
Mm-hmm.
But increasing this budget makes sense because when we have a tough winter, we're always scrambling at the end, trying to transfer money from one source or another into snow and ice in order to avoid a deficit into the next year. The import of increase in a snow and ice budget means that you can deficit spend that budget so long as you in future years do not decrease that appropriation. So by doing the increase here, we're setting a new bar by which we
carry forward.
We have to carry us forward.
Now on deficit spending, you just told Donald that you cannot include salaries in the deficit spending on snow removal?
Whatever the categories here are, so the overtime, yes, you can.
So you can. So salt, overtime.
Snow removal is salaries.
Yeah.
Yes, that's salaries. Yeah. Overtime salaries.
I thought you could deficit spend this entire bucket.
Yes, you can, but if you should in, let's say in FY19, we decide to decrease this budget, then you lose that ability to deficit spend.
Because you can only deficit spend up to the amount of the prior fiscal year? Something like that?
No, they want to see an
You can't monkey with this to balance the budget, is what you're saying.
Right.
Well, you
yeah.
can.
Yeah, 1 year.
1 year you can.
Yeah. Okay.
So long as the amount raised at town meeting equaled or exceeded the amount raised for snow and ice in the previous fiscal year.
I was
right.
concerned. I thought you were trying to tell Donald that we couldn't. That we couldn't deficit spend on the overtime, that we could only deficit
yeah,
spend.
Yeah, you can.
Okay, thank you.
I misunderstood the question.
This budget is the one budget that you can deficit spend. But the Department of Revenue wants to see the town to maintain a certain level of fiscal effort
mm-hmm.
in order to allow that deficit spending. In other words, we can't cut this back to zero and then deficit than whatever expense we would be able to put onto next year's tax rate. They don't want to see something like that.
How about the patch? Isn't that double of what we're looking at for the last few years spending? We're at 57 and we're going to 11. We went at 11 last year. And the last two times, it looks like we're spending about between 57, half of that.
Yeah, 50.
Is there an opportunity there at all, or do you think that needs to be at 11?
I would say there is an opportunity there, if you show the trend. And again, that's affected by the severity of your winters, too.
15 was the bad winter, horrible winter. Well, if we need to identify opportunities for savings, let's earmark that as an opportunity for us, please.
And snow and ice, unexpended funds roll into free cash like everything else, right?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Right. I kind of keyed in on the salt. I just didn't want us to be in a position where as salt keeps increasing, and then we're deficit further and further in the hole each year with the increase to salt prices and what we've been expending. We're already expending the last 3 years much more than what we got in that actual line item. But with David's description, it is my opinion that you don't want to over budget your snow and ice either, because you could get in trouble going the other way. So
how are we doing right now with this year's budget? I know the last time you were in, you said you wanted to buy some additional salt as a safeguard. So we should have most of that in the shed now, right?
Yeah, most of it's, the invoices are on their way, but as far as the budget, we're running right about zero right now, somewhere thereabouts. I mean,
so it improved a little bit since the last time you were here?
Yes.
Significantly?
Yes. I mean, so when I got the VADAR updated and the numbers came in on the invoices, I had a more solid number. I was kind of running on just my instinct when mm-hmm. we met last time, so.
That's good.
Okay, street light?
Street light, there's a small decrease other than that.
All this talk about going now with the LEDs.
Yeah.
Do you have any history, when you were in Greenfield, did you have any history of using the LEDs and what the opportunities were for savings up there, or did you not have LEDs up there?
The last few years I was there, I think every street light in town, of course, we maintained our own in Greenfield. So we hired a contractor. Once a month they come in and do the list of lights that weren't working properly. But we ended up getting a grant through the energy department, and I think most of them were replaced under grant, free of charge or close to free of charge. They went to all LEDs.
So we did, through a grant, we got a feasibility study for replacing all of our, owning and replacing all of our street lights, and it looks like there's some opportunities for savings there. So we're going to plug that into the capital program for the summer.
Next year, maybe.
I spoke to David. Phil spoke to me about this. He was the one that implemented the University of Massachusetts program.
Mm-hmm.
And initially there was some cost, naturally, but now there's significant savings, he say. And he suggested to me that we should investigate that and get into LED lighting. You know, and the thing is, most people don't realize in the early 80s, as a board, there was over 400 streetlights shut off in this town, and they never came back. The only streetlights that are in this town are at intersections and dangerous curves. There's, you know, we're very frugal with our street lighting in this town now, so. And I think the LEDs would serve a better purpose to light these dangerous areas.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's something that should be investigated.
You mean in terms of effectiveness?
Yeah, effectiveness and clarity of vision in those intersections from all angles, things like that.
Yep.
You know? Hey, David, along with the grant, is there anything that the power company's doing themselves with streetlights or not? You were going to look into it at one time.
They're making money every month.
So they're not too interested in doing it then?
No.
We used to have a light, though, that was down coming off Bay Road. Entrance, you come over the bridge. For some reason, that light's out now. It used to be there, and it lights the right turn coming onto Bay Road. And I'd like to see about getting that fixed, please.
You have that, Marlon?
Yep.
I'm assuming that whoever bought, it may be that whoever bought the gas station was paying for it and decided that they didn't want to pay for it anymore.
Yeah, it could be a funny, but I'll take a peek at it.
Katie on the corner there, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, highway building maintenance?
Highway building maintenance. I think Chief Mason met with you last week, and David and the chief kind of ran you through a lot of what was going on with this.
Mm-hmm.
But to summarize, we took the maintenance items out of the public safety budget end of it and put it into the DPW building maintenance. I've been talking for a couple of months with both chiefs about this. And we all agreed that it would be a good idea for the DPW to take care of the little things, as you will. The maintaining of the different things over there that they don't have to worry about on a daily basis. So the overall budget from last year, if I got my figures right here, under 5430, there's a $2,600 that's showing on, I think, on your budget book that's going back to public safety for maintenance supplies. Originally, we had agreed on that's what would happen, and it got shifted around, but that needs to go back to their budget. And also, I think there's another item of $3,000 right below that, same thing. It's going back to the fire side of supplies for the year. So. With the $5,000 difference, I think it's $122,200 is what the budget will be now, as opposed to $61,500 last year. It shows a $20,000 increase to the building maintenance budget. The rest were transfers, if I'm reading this correctly. So that's where we're at with the building maintenance budget. And it's kind of a transition year for the building maintenance budget. Obviously, with the two new buildings coming aboard and everything, this may look quite different 2 years from now. We're going to have to think ahead about maintaining the new buildings and getting them on a maintenance schedule and stuff like that with the different things they're going to need.
So the personnel associated with this are not in here. Where would this maintenance subdivision, mechanic and the building maintenance coordinator be?
Oh.
So their salaries aren't in here, right?
Right. I broke out on the flow chart I gave you, or the org chart, if you will.
Yep.
The way my budget's set up right now, under the highway salaries labor, highway laborers salaries,
mm-hmm.
Your building maintenance coordinator laborer comes out of there now, as well as the mechanic.
And the mechanic, okay.
But I broke them out to show that we're moving. I did a little study on the building maintenance coordinator laborer, and when we put in time each week, I broke down the time for a year, and it's looking like that person who is being paid out of highway is in building maintenance about 78% of their time, mm-hmm. actually dealing with building issues and building coordinations, if you will. So. I decided to break it out into subdivisions to reflect a little bit of what the department really looks like, what we're doing on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
So that salary is still reflective in the highway budget at this point in mm-hmm. time. We haven't directly moved anything yet as far as that.
Mm-hmm.
So this is strictly for routine maintenance of the buildings. There's nothing in there for, larger projects to be done if they notice something, that is in gray and it has to be done.
It has been bumped by $20,000 this year.
Yeah. I always thought that wasn't enough, according to the Building Needs Committee.
I actually talked to them last night at the Building Committee's meeting, and I'd like to set up an appointment so that Gary, yourself, myself, and David could sit down and have a meeting and try to understand the monies where they are and what's available to us. I know that there's been some monies that are pre-committed to projects that are already committed, and let's just sit down and understand where those are and what projects are being taken care of with that. And then I think it'll give us a better idea as to whether or not it'd give us a much better idea as to whether or not that 20,000 was. They were very happy to get the extra 20. Very happy. But we're getting in the right direction, and you're right, there's two new buildings coming online that we don't think are going to be as
costly.
We need to look more as to how.
When I look at it, Jerry, I don't want to see these buildings neglected again. And that money has to be there to maintain them at a certain level. And if it isn't, then we're neglecting them again. And I don't want to see that happen.
Excellent.
Molly, to finish the question you asked, there's, as we know, we have another retirement coming in December, and that all came about after I had formed the budget and looked at everything. So we may have some wiggle room there to see how these buildings and how it's going to work out to shift the org chart a little bit more. Also, under that, we have a supervisor in highway that the position's going to be consolidated back into the highway department. So.
Did you take into consideration, though, with the retirement, sick time paid out and vacation time paid out in December?
No, not yet.
Because that could be another factor of not having anything to play with.
Right, right. Yeah. There may be a gap there before I could.
Yeah.
So
I don't know what's on the books, but
some of it could be managed between now and then.
Correct.
It's a good notion.
So,
yeah.
So the point I was trying to make is with the shift from that work and foreman's position to highway and the potential retirement, if we need to shift where we think we need someone full-time completely dedicated to building maintenance, including myself, which I'm administrative, that's where this is trending, mm-hmm. be administrative over the buildings. But if we need to dedicate the building maintenance coordinator laborer full time, then I think we're going to have that wiggle room within the budget here to do that.
Does Mr. Berg have some available time to still do highway work, or is he almost totally dedicated to building maintenance?
Well, like 22%. I said, we fill out the white slips, something I instituted when I first started here, for data, if you will. And his hours, 78% of his hours are directly dedicated to building maintenance right now.
I didn't know that.
You know, plus
so then you do have a little room, but
yeah,
I just want to make sure there's enough man hours in here for Mr. Berg to accomplish this budget.
Yes.
You know, if there is, then we're fine.
Yes. I think a lot may not change on Mr. Berg's end. I mean, if I'm going to take over the administrative end of it, he doesn't have to worry about running with the administrative end of it. Dealing with contractors, dealing with schedules, dealing with the maintenance, performing some of the smaller maintenance issues, I think it would be in line. I have to update a job description when we get to that point, but I mean, I think that's what we're looking at right now.
Okay, we're rolling into cemeteries then, next page.
Before we transfers. 490. The library part of it, as you know, the library requires a certain amount of spending in order to qualify for their annual grant and their certification. So the reason why I've spelled out everything within the library on this particular budget is so that they can track their expenses and prove to the state that they're investing in their services.
The other small piece before we move on, I almost forgot, was you know, being a level services budget, I wanted to add in a small piece that David and I have been in discussion on as far as the DPW actually mowing the Council of Aging, the Town Hall, Russell School, and the library. I was taking that over in-house as opposed to contracting it out. So
and we have
added
equipment?
Service. Yes, I may have to make a purchase on one mower, but it's not going to be a hefty expense. So Small mower. Yes. Oh no, nothing like the big mower down there. That
no,
will fit
no
in
the
front
air conditioning.
Yard here.
It's a little
no
private.
Air conditioning.
No. You might be able to get you a deal somewhere.
Just helping you head off a ruckus.
A small zero turn mower that doesn't come with a cab or anything.
Excellent.
Like that. So I hope that better explains it.
We probably could get you one without a motor.
Sickle.
That'd even be better.
Next.
Cemeteries, checking in again with Gary Berg recently. Nothing's changing there. The contracted services are going to remain the same. And nothing there needed to be increased.
Okay. The salary cemetery, is that strictly an allocation?
I'm trying to think how that works.
Yeah, we're billed monthly for 8 months of the year.
Okay.
so we're not built during the wintertime for sort of upkeep of the cemetery.
Yeah, but that goes under salary, not contracted services?
It's a contracted service, really. It's not really a salary.
Yeah, no, but I'm just wanting $5,500 in salary.
Where's the salaries from?
Is that, that's not an internal on the payroll person?
It's not a payroll expense, no.
Okay, so shouldn't salary be zero and contracted services be?
We can do it that way.
Yeah, can combine them.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it's, salary to me is payroll.
What's the contractual? Oh, just $12,000?
No, I think it's, well, could we just get a follow-up on that?
Sure.
We don't need to, but if you could look into that and then just let us know. Okay, Finance Committee, Mr. Pitta?
What does it mean, where does your burial cost a funded for revolving fund? Like, who are we burying?
So when we sell a cemetery lot, and that money goes into a separate pot of money, a revolving fund, that's actually going to come up on the agenda next. That revolving fund then can be used without further appropriation for that cost.
So when a family buys a plot, is that what you mean?
Yeah, so when they buy a plot, they also buy the internment, that pays for the backhoe that'll dig the grave, so.
I'll get Benjamin to dig mine, don't worry.
Does the town have a perpetual care fund, like most cemeteries do? People can donate to them?
You know, I think there are some under the trust fund. That's something that the treasurer can speak more clearly about, but I think that there are a couple.
Which, I'm glad Donald just brought that up, because one of the things I was going to ask is when probably the night that the treasurer's here, when we do those town hall departments, could we make sure that she brings in with her the balance sheet accounts that have all of the trust funds and on it?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, sorry, so back to enterprise funds. Are we going to wastewater and water?
So on page 68.
Okay, the wastewater budget. I'm looking down at the bottom. Again, the overall budget is showing a minus 6.33% from last year. And I'll run down the main points. The one small addition is $12,800 for the newly created field superintendent position. The piece of this is the previous superintendent was water and water and highway only. So a portion of the new field superintendent is going to fall under sewer as direct supervision or overseeing field operations, not necessarily the plant directly operations, but the field work when it's happening. Clerical salary, that's been decreased by 12.67%, equates to a 5 hours less a week for the clerical in that position. And then we're looking at, for the collective bargaining agreement, about 7404 combined, rather than read them each off to you. The one thing that really throws the numbers off on the minus 6.33 is the sludge removal treatment 5380 account. If we all remember, we ran into the issue last year with Montague closing up, and we had to pay big, big money to have our sludge hauled to other places much further away. Since then, we've signed a contract with Lowell, and the numbers at what they're at now, it's going to be about $162,000 for the year. But I do want to say, Montague's been up and running about a month ago, month and a half now.
A little over a month.
And they're starting to take a load of ours now and then. They're not completely up and running and taking everything. Once they get through their DEP things that, you know, DEP wants to see them change and all that, it may be a full-blown operation again at some point. But it's unknown at this point, so I budgeted the Lowell amount under contract in case that happens to close up again on us. So originally we had $241,000 in there before we got into the contractual thing with Lowell. So it's a $79,000 for even number, $79,000 cut to the budget. So, I think I ran the numbers earlier today. I didn't really put them in there, but we're somewhere right around the same percentages as the other overall budgets, plus or minus 0.12% if you take the sludge factor out of it. Mm-hmm. That sounded good, sludge factor. But, so that's our sewer budget.
Okay. Any questions on sewer?
Yeah, I do. Mm-hmm. I've learned a lot more about this budget because of Hadley Media and how it's structured and things of that nature. When we're dealing with enterprise funds, what I want to know is, where is the interest money from the enterprise funds going? Are they going back into the fund, or is it going into the general fund?
No, it can't go in the general
fund. By law, it can't.
No, it has to go back in the
enterprise. Right, I just want to make sure that's happening.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We had a town meeting vote on that, right, years ago, where we had to pay it back, and we moved it back in over like a 3-year period or something.
I guess we're going to have some discussion the way I understand it now. With the Hadley Media, it wasn't and still isn't. And if it isn't there, that means it's not being done in the other two, probably.
No, I think.
And I need clarification on it.
Isn't that part of the state law,
Hadley
David,
Media,
that it has
TV,
to go back into the enterprise
our
fund?
Our TV station.
He means that when during his discussions about their enterprise fund,
yeah,
right.
It came to his attention that the
this has always been going back into their own enterprises.
I think that's mandated by the state. It is,
and that's why years ago we had to go to town meeting to move monies back because they hadn't been, because we made the error or whatever, and then we had to put them back. So
but when
you
calculate these budgets,
David, that's when Robin was here, right?
You know, we're getting chargebacks to all these departments now, and in reality it's supposed to be 10%. Hadley Media was getting charged 23%. So if they had a budget originally of kickbacks that were coming back to 18,000, now it's been reduced to 6,000. And they can actually get money back from last year's budget. So if this is happening there, I think it's happening in the two enterprise funds too.
No.
And if somebody proves me I'm wrong, I'll accept it, but they gotta prove I'm wrong.
Okay, yeah, we're gonna have that discussion about the chargebacks. We'll probably have a whole separate discussion about that. So. But at any rate, David, could you just confirm that we're talking about the interest?
Yeah. Under the enterprise fund, the interest that is earned in that account stays in that account. It's one of the things that we researched when we were creating Hadley Media in the first place. We could have run it as a special revenue account, but that meant that the interest would go to the general fund. And we decided that was not the fair way of doing it. So that's why we specifically went with the enterprise fund. The only other option we had was to do it as a revolving fund, and the Department of Revenue, for reasons that I don't understand, said no.
Okay.
So,
okay. So, but again, we'll just confirm.
We can confirm that, but that was very much part of our thinking when we created Hadley Media.
Okay.
We'll
talk about that another night. The Hadley Media is on the agenda another night.
Yep. A couple of our line items here seem to be a little bit out of whack, if you ask me. I don't know. Our chlorination supplies, if we look historically, we got 957, we got a 1768, and we keep budgeting at 6,500. That's three times what we're actually spending historically. That seems a little much for me. In addition, if you look down to the dues, licensing, and training, again, same thing. We spent 1,400 one year, we spent $900 the next year, and we're budgeting at 5,000. It seems like we're over budgeting on those for what historically we're ending up using for those.
Are you forcing training?
Excuse me?
Or are you forcing training to occur that hasn't been?
Well, the thing is sometimes you have to take what trainings are available.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And you may get a free class now and then. You may have a year where you get 10 free classes the following year because those classes are kind of get grants or whatever when they put them on, but you may run into a year where you have to pay $1,200 for a two-day course or a one-day course.
The licenses are on a two-year
cycle.
So you may not be spending the money the first year because nobody went to classes, but the next year it may almost double.
Even so, we're budgeting for three times what we spend on the highest year.
Yeah, because that would make sense. So if 15 was the heavier license year and then it dropped down to 900, to
right.
Jerry's point,
So even if it, even if we pay.
See what you're saying.
Even if we're double, that's 3,000 there. Even if we're double, the chlorination supplies, it, you know, we're at 1768. We're budgeting for 6,500. I just think that we're, again, if we're looking at our numbers and we're trying to make sure that they come in.
That number may have stayed the same for all the years because when we go out to bid every year for that, the bidding does change also. So I know we're not expending the full amount again. I see what you're saying there too.
And we
but it depends on the bid, you know. You right. could be paying more the next year for the same amount of chlorines.
Internet the last 2 years. I mean, at 749, 654, and we increased our budget there by $1,100. Now that might be, there might be a reason for that. I just haven't heard one. So
what you're looking at is the 732 actual from 2016. Skipping over the year with the whole
yeah, I'm looking
anomaly,
at the
and then comparing it to the 917.
I'm looking at the actuals for the last 2 years versus what we're budgeting. But and if we're budgeting three times what we have actually spent in either one of those two previous years, I think we need to just take a look at those.
Yeah.
Does the internet include the maintenance program that we instituted on vehicles, Marlo?
No, not this one.
Not on that?
No.
I thought maybe that was the reason for the increase.
On the internet? No, that was strictly running.
Because it had GPS there, so.
I think we're expecting an increase in that, and also part of that fee is the there's a small fee for now that our manholes are mapped and we start adding all our lines to the manhole mapping. We have to pay a fee for being in the cloud on that and updating it per year. It's a small fee. It's not thousands of dollars, but
is that internet and cable part of the two new missions we put in at the two new
yes,
stations?
Yes,
also
that's also okay. the increase
that's
too.
That's the other one.
We had the increase of the two new pump stations that now have the mission that will talk to us when something's going wrong there. So that's part
it's
of the
like internet, a self-contained SCADA unit per station that we tried out on the two new stations. It seems to be working out quite well. So
yes, okay.
But there is a cost to it.
So Marla, do you think you could follow up on the, you can just shoot an email out maybe to David, you can circulate it with a response to Jerry's questions?
That was 5537, Jerry?
Yeah, let's make sure we add 5240, that's up 30 grand. And you know, if there's answers for these, you know, I just need to hear them. You know, if our internet's changing, that's fine. But if we're, it's uniforms, it's chlorination supplies. If it's IT, sewer facilities maintenance is. 2 years ago was 21. This year's 47, and we're budgeting for 80.
I had another question, David. Principal, long-term debt.
Yep.
Are the two new pump stations in there at $2 million already or not? Is that what that $1,000 increase is right now? Or?
Yes. So okay. we're beginning to pay that. In FY18, we're going to be paying that principal and interest for those projects.
I think I also, sorry. The sewer facility maintenance, I think we figured in changing a few more pumps, if I'm remembering right. That's why that's been bumped up.
Okay.
Excellent.
Because that's part of the program. Yeah. You'll see in the writings that's what we've been working on. I want to continue on changing the pumps out. We got some old pumps out there. John knows best. He's been changing them. So. Yeah.
And if we get that,
some of them are obsolete and they just need to be rebuilt. So
yeah.
What caused the drastic decrease in the vehicle parts? It was 15,000 reduced to 5 from 16. Did we get the newer trucks?
Yes, we got.
Is that was the result?
Two new pickups, and we took the tanker off the road.
I took the tanker off the road, which you know we're going to have to address that at some point. That's another subject. But yes, the two new vehicles. We obviously won't be working on them as much as the two that went down the road. So mm-hmm. I certainly saw decreasing that wasn't a problem at all.
It's good.
Could we make sure any budget questions that are asked at these meetings, make sure that if there's any response, it goes to the Finance Committee as well?
Yep.
Okay. All right, moving on. Okay. One question, just sewer rates, water rates. When are we going to be ready to have that discussion?
We need to have that discussion in March and or April this year in order to make it for FY18.
So are we going to be ready to have that discussion next week?
No, not next week, but the week after, in April, first meeting in April.
Don't we have a last meeting in March on the
29th?
I don't, you set that aside as a possible meeting date. We can do it for the 29th if you wish.
I want to see how next week turns out.
Yeah, I mean, in all likelihood, we're going to do two, but. Okay, Robert?
Okay, water. Again, to peek down the bottom, our overall increase of the water budget is 0.11%. with basically the same collective bargaining agreement put in place, salaries put in place. Water facility maintenance, that's been increased $7,500. We've inspected a lot of our other facilities, such as the Mount Warner, where the tanks are on the outside of the large water tanks. We have some severe corrosion issue going on with valves and dresser couplings. So we definitely needed the extra money to do some of them repairs before we have a failure from one of the tanks. Also part of that is previous to the pump testing that the money was approved for at the Mount Warner Wells, we need to go through them headworks. They haven't run, a lot of it hasn't run in many years. It does not look like I want to throw the on button on some of it. So we need to go through it. We need to replace a valve or two or whatever we need to do in order to do that pump test.
It's clean water. It's
fine. Yeah, I know. There's a lot of it. So that's where your increase is there. Water meter repair and maintenance. We dropped that on $5,000 because I'm glad to report as of today we got 100 meters left to change out. So it's been a long process, but we're right at number 100.
That's great.
Left. So we were able to decrease that budget. We don't need to buy as many meters. Engineering services. Sharon put some of this together. We have a lot of calibrations on different parts and pieces of the plant that we need to change out. So there's an increase there of $9,000 for the calibrations. We can't purchase the equipment, nor can we know how to use the equipment. So we have to hire out to do that.
On with your tanks you were talking about, was there any talk about putting that other tank back online with a mixer? For capacity,
we haven't talked about it yet. No, we're trying to get through the unidirectional flushing and all the other things we got on our plate right now, and the valve mapping. The valve mapping. So there's a lot happening, but it's on the to-do list. So let's see.
Our electricity. Let's talk about that for a minute, if we can. I see where your budget number is there. Last year we spent 151. You budgeted for 125. You anticipate your electrical bill to be down this year significantly because we're not pumping as much?
Well, we don't know what this coming year summer is going to bring us. I do know that we're going to be way over in the existing budget right now from last summer with it pumping off the hook, I think was the words I was using. But yeah. We're like at just shy of 90% on our electricity budget right now, or 88% or something like that. So.
You feel comfortable with that 125 number? You think that needs to be increased?
I feel comfortable. I mean, it's wishful thinking that we're not in this. I mean, to match last year's drought would be really bad, and I would hope that it wouldn't happen. So they're still saying the numbers are down. I mean, as far as the amount of precip we've gotten, but
water facilities maintenance last year the bill was $53,000, you budgeted for 24. Was there significant increases or spendings that was double what you anticipate you're going to spend this year?
Yes, we have a list of things that didn't have to be done immediately because, I mean, overall the water budget's been hit really hard. The drought affected the water budget in many ways. Mm-hmm. So we put some of the things off that we felt we could put off in the actual plant. In the other facilities. So that's what the increase is for, is to cover us on those things and whatever else may surprise us this coming budget year and with the plan. Vehicle parts and supplies, same identical thing as sewer. I took $3,800 out of that. We got two fairly new vehicles in the department, so I took $3,800 out of there. So what goes along with the electricity, Jerry, is the water chemicals and analysis. You'll see a good bump there. More water we're pumping, the more analysis and stuff we're going to need for that end of it too. It kind of goes hand in hand with the electricity.
Are we bidding the chlorine for the water and the wastewater or not?
Yes. It's actually bid through the COG, but it comes
They're
out a separate.
They're the same percentages, aren't they?
Yes, I think so. That bid doesn't come out. They're staggered throughout the year. That bid doesn't come out until April, I think, or May or something. Or the actual.
Just before the physical year.
Yeah. Whereas the highway one we talked about earlier was due today or whatever. So, yeah. Salt and sands also bid out in October. You know, so they stagger them all over the place. So.
The billing's up. You budgeted double on the billing what we spent for the last two fiscal years on it.
We're anticipating going to quarterly billing, so that's why that increased.
Okay. But there's a mutual benefit to that as well.
Oh, yes.
Where will we see that?
That benefit will be in increased cash flow, you should see some efficiencies in money management there. So.
And a major trigger in helping us find unaccounted for water if we're reading more frequently.
Mark quicker for the citizens.
I mean, we can have pumping numbers, but it can be dry, so it's kind of hard to tell, is that a leak or are we just using a lot of water? We don't know until we bill. So it's all staggered like that. But quarterly billing would definitely be able to.
Didn't we go ahead with that?
Yeah, mm-hmm. you took a vote.
But when is that?
That starts in August.
Okay.
Yeah.
Vehicle supplies. I see our budget number's actually down, but the usage that we've had previous history seems to be significantly less than the line item budget.
So we have new equipment?
Which would mean it would go down, not up.
It did go down.
It went down, but still not to offset the $4,900 that we paid for actual expenses.
Okay.
Oh, you think it should have gone down more?
More.
I'm looking at it saying we're budgeting for three times what we actually spent last year, and we have
new equipment.
Yeah,
gotcha.
And
the other thing I want to mention for that, Jerry, is it's not just the two water trucks. There's multi-use pieces of equipment the department uses that water has to pay their fair share on, and as well as sewer needs to pay their fair share. So, to use the Vactor as an example, if we're using the Vactor on water mains. To help out on water mains. If we have a major repair on that, there's a possibility it could be split three ways among the three budgets. So I'm not saying there needs to be fat there, but there could be a hard hit on all three budgets if we have a major repair. So
yeah, I think we did that with the suction tube.
Yeah.
We split it three ways when we bought that.
I just wanted to put that out there, that there's multi pieces of equipment that are charged amongst the three departments, not just one. So. If there's a major repair, we may take a piece of it out of water, sewer, and highway. So
I absolutely hear you, but I'm looking at actuals from the last 2 years where we followed the exact same scenario that you just explained to me.
Okay.
And we're budgeting for three times what we're actually spending. So I'm wondering if three times is where we need to be. And the same with the water and sewer pipe supplies. I mean, exact same scenario. We're budgeting for double what historically we're spending.
I think that was always left high with anticipation of water breaks.
Well,
or sewer breaks or something like that, you know, because you can never plan that stuff.
The water supplies and pipe I'd like to speak to. Last year we did 24 excavations in-house. I want to tell you about the budget I'm in right now. I don't have the numbers on me, but our budget has been hit hard because we're doing a lot of work in-house we haven't done in recent years.
But your outside service number is virtually non-existent.
Right, but we're, rather than four excavations or five contracting out, we get 24 out of our help. But in the meantime, I'm spending more money in-house on parts and pieces because we're doing the quantities of work. So I did increase that because we do have a heavy schedule this coming summer, more hydrants, more valves, more service lines. What I'm saying here is, as I'm telling you, we're going to use it because we're working.
Have you been replacing a stock that we have, some of it, or none of it?
Yes. We've been trying to rotate it out because I know some of it's been there.
Some of it's pretty old,
yeah.
But other ones, a lot of the odd sizes really need to be in stock because they have to be special orders.
Yeah. And as you know, the other thing we're dodging, there's a lot of stuff that we can't use anymore because of the lead. So.
Yeah.
Okay, so if you could just tack that onto your list to follow up in an email. It's just helpful to us because then when we come roll into the next year and we see the actuals, then it helps educate us too. So Jerry's just looking for justification, that's all. All right, is that it for any other questions for Marlo on water or any of the other components of the DPW?
It's not a question of your budget, but I'm concerned. Pride is really kicking up, and you can see these gigantic loam piles there. What guarantee, I know we have a bylaw and no loam is supposed to leave the town of Hadley. What safeguard do we have to protect us that that loam doesn't leave Hadley?
I believe the actual bylaw says that the loam can't be scraped on the property that's not being excavated. So if you have a cellar hole that you're actually digging, that loam can leave Hadley, but the rest of it cannot. You cannot scrape 6 feet of loam and backfill it with sand. But I think where you're excavating for a foundation, that loam is for the person's who's...
But I guess what I'm trying to say, Jerry, the loam there far exceeds the buildings. They had small buildings on all that property and a lot of loam everywhere. And if you watch as they grow, they're just beginning. They're mountains. So, you know, I just want to know the rules and the safeguard to protect some of that.
I think where they're digging now, where you see that big pile, Donald, is where the stormwater containment's going to go. So that's probably, most of that's going to be dammed up and put back and reused at whatever design they have for it. Because I know there was a holding pond there or something, or a detention pond.
I'm just looking at the bylaw, and it says that the planning board has jurisdiction over this, and any soil removal needs a permit from the planning board.
Okay.
So they would be enforcing it.
Yeah, I was saying, it sounds like, I mean, I think Donald's also saying, too, is who's
responsible for... I don't know how much is actually loam there. There's a lot of sand there, too.
The building inspector.
Beautiful stuff.
Yeah.
Is it the building inspector?
He's the, right?
He'd be the zoning enforcement officer.
Zoning enforcement officer, yeah.
This is technically a general bylaw, but it clearly says it's the planning board that's in charge here.
He's the zoning officer.
Yeah.
Okay. So maybe we can get clarification from the planning board and find out, you know, have they been given any permits or anything like that for that?
Just ask Tim.
Yeah, or Tim. Yeah, one or the other.
Okay, so sewer facility maintenance, chlorination supplies and sewer, and vehicle parts supplies and water, I need to follow up on.
Just an explanation.
I have a list, but they told me to stop talking, so I'll have the list and I'll get it to you. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Any other questions for Marlo before he... finishes? Okay, excellent, thank you. So,
and how about a congratulations on being here for a year, Marlo? Great job. Thanks.
Welcome to the jungle, as they say.
Happy anniversary.
Before you go, do you want to update us on the organizational chart you passed out, or just let it go for now? I know you spoke to us briefly about it, but it seemed to have changed drastically from the other ones we reviewed.
We've already been doing this an hour.
Yeah. Well, real brief. I think I had presented two in the past, and I landed right in the middle. A lot's changed since we last talked about it. So this org chart, as I explained when I went through the budget numbers, the working foreman will be a newly created position called crew chief within the highway department. And there was a decrease of 5 hours with the sewer admin assistant. And we broke down the subdivisions for highway, building maintenance, and mechanics. It has a different look, but it's coming out of the same numbers right now until we move some other things with that.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so do we want to go into the warrant articles then? Okay, so we're starting just a handful of the warrant articles. David's going to just walk us through.
Does everybody have a copy of the most recent warrant?
I think so.
Finance Committee, do you all have?
Yep.
You want to keep that?
I
got a copy.
I'll get one for him tomorrow. Oh, you got another one?
Can I get off the hot seat, Jerry?
You got another one?
Okay, so Article 4, revolving funds.
All right. So last week, we went through the articles that are in the consent agenda. This week, we're going to tuck into this warrant a little bit more. This is article, starts with Article 4. This is something that we've seen every year. We're required by law to re-vote all of our revolving funds. Now, revolving funds are special activities within the, that are outside of the budget, where user fees are used to pay for the service, so that's not a burden on the taxpayers. We have on page 3, we have eight revolving funds. The first one is the burial revolving fund that pays for the interment for all five cemeteries, or as many cemeteries that still do burials. Our electrical inspector is paid out of the revolving funds, and we keep a 10% of those electrical inspection fees as a administrative charge. The tax title, this will be the second year of doing this, so people who are delinquent on their taxes, rather than having taxpayers pay for the advertising and the legal fees associated with tax titles, this is all done with seed money that we raised a couple of years ago, and then the money that we spend on collecting back taxes goes right back into here, except for the taxes themselves, which go back to the general fund. The recyclables, this is an agreement that we have with the vendor that runs our transfer station, that whatever, this is an incentive to maximize recycling, so whatever recycling is done, they get money from the MRF that goes back into this revolving fund and goes to the management company. Dog control, again, 50% of fines and fees goes to pay for expenses associated with controlling dogs, as dog food or vet's bills or so forth. Russell School, we still have some rental income coming into the Russell School, and so this pays for the expenses of upkeep.
Can I just stop there for
sure.
a second?
Sure.
Had a fair amount of conversations about the funds that were in this Russell School.
Yes.
And then we agreed to move those out and allow them to be expended for other purposes.
Yes.
We put under capital, didn't we, though? Not the capital, but the building maintenance.
But wasn't that done with a town meeting vote?
Yes, it was. And
so it was the will of the townspeople that did that.
So I can,
I'm just saying that people have asked, so I just want to recap.
Right. So we still have a balance of $83,995.87 in that money that was transferred out of the revolving fund when North Star was there, and is now available for expenditure on for maintenance on any municipal building without a further appropriation from town meetings. So we have, just in that one account there, we have $84,000.
So that money is no longer earmarked for Russell. It could be used for Russell, but it doesn't have to be used for
Russell.
But the monies that have come in since that town meeting vote from the state are back in this revolving fund?
Yes.
Specifically for that building?
Specifically for the upkeep, not the upkeep, but the maintenance
operations costs of the building.
So if we were to shutter the building, if we were to kick the tenant out, we have, I think, $350 for upkeep of Russell School. That's minimum power in the smoke alarm, and that's it.
Mm-hmm.
But this pays for all the other costs associated with having a tenant in there. Sealer of Weights and Measures, this will be the second year that we've done this. We've been working with the City of Northampton to provide this service, which is mandated by law. Last year we had an uneven experience with this revolving fund. I've been working with Susan Wright over at Northampton in order to make sure that we don't have the same performance issues that we had last year. And then Park and Rec, this will be the second year of this particular
revolving fund, which they requested because they can spend more money and have a higher cap than the revolving fund that would normally be allowed by state law. So there are actually no changes from last year.
Okay, so that's Article 4.
That's Article 4.
Article 9?
Article 9, this is over on page 8. This is one, yet again, an opportunity afforded by the Municipal Modernization Act. And I've written it out as a conceptual article, and I'll work on the final language. But to enact a local bylaw that allows revolving funds per state law for any board that uses consultants in order to do work. Now, so Conservation Commission and Planning Board are allowed by law currently to use consultants to review complicated plans for big developments. Building inspector, the fire department may not do that, and yet they're expected to handle the same set of plans. This would expand the authority of the town to allow for the building inspector and the fire chief to hire consultants at the expense of the developer to review complicated plans. So this,
we already have that in water and sewer, correct?
You have that in water and sewer, but you don't have it in all of your departments that still have to deal with so this would free up staff time. It would also give a level of expertise to complicated reviews that are difficult to achieve evenly across all the departments here.
Okay. Article 10?
Article 10, long-range plan implementation committee. It's a little complicated. We have the long-range plan implementation committee was created by town meeting vote back in 2005 in order to help with the implementation of the 2005 master plan. This committee has become inactive. They haven't met since 2014.
And there's no need for them to resurrect the planning board's working with PVPC on the master plan.
That's correct. And in fact, by state law, the master plan is under the purview of the planning board. So there's always a difficult relationship between the planning board and this particular committee. Because this committee was formed by town meeting vote, it needs to be dissolved by town meeting vote. So I'm asking that we lay this committee down because it's performed its service very well. And we have implemented many parts of the 2005 master plan, but with the new update of the master plan, we should streamline the implementation process.
Okay. Article 12
and 13 are two articles that are joined by the HIP. We have a solar developer, Nexamp, is putting together two solar projects which will collectively amount to about 5 megawatts of solar energy generated annually. They're going to be set up as, they're calling it Hadley 3 and Hadley 4. They'll be under two different corporate names. So we're going to use Article 12 for the 3 megawatt facility, in Article 13 for the 2 megawatt facility.
Is it Eversource that's over there on South Maple and Moody?
Right, so yeah. 13 was originally set up to provide a pilot agreement for Eversource. Eversource said, thank you, we're not interested for business reasons. We're not gonna do a pilot with the town. More money for us up front, so I'm happy. So they said no, but we still need a placeholder for NEXAP under 13. And the deal is that solar fields by law are the only entity that's allowed to approach the town and negotiate a payment in lieu of taxes, a pilot agreement, rather than paying straight taxation. And the benefit to the developer is that they get to manage their cash flow over a 20-year period more evenly, and the benefit to the town of Hadley, if we negotiate these things in the correct way, is that we actually end up with more tax money at the end of the day, so everybody wins. And we have, in the process of negotiating with NextAmp on this facility, and that'll be brought forward to the Select Board in the next week or two.
There's some opposition to that over there.
A lot of opposition.
South Maple and Moody.
Right, that's an Eversource project. That's not this one here.
Okay.
And I understand that there is some opposition there. They're aware of it as well.
Yeah.
The only problem I have with it, David, is the solar arrays, yes, is a moneymaker for us, but it's taken some of our most valuable farmland, they're putting them on, you know, in areas, you know, and that sort of puts a sad note to me, you know, that you just don't get any more farmland like we have in the town of Hadley, you know, and I wish there was another way to go about it, but there isn't. You know, it's something we have to live with, I guess, you know, because they are exempt, apparently, so, you know.
Legitimate reason of the planning board not to move forward.
Article 14, this is the first of two articles relating to recreational marijuana. This probably could be deferred for a year. I'm asking for a one-year moratorium on the siting of sales places for recreational marijuana. The legislature is also pushing back all the deadlines. I won't give you a rundown of this. But there is a local option for a local option tax on recreational marijuana, same as we have for room occupancy tax and same as we have for meals tax. The law says currently 2%. That may change, but it's an opportunity to get some revenue.
Now that we have recreational marijuana, we also have an opportunity to renegotiate that contract, don't we?
Do we have to vote on that?
Yes.
We're not voting on any of this today.
So.
Okay. I'll take it off
but it's all going to be put off for now anyway, so.
Yeah, the state is to push back all the deadlines by 6 months because whether you take the perspective that the ballot question was written poorly or permissively, there's a lot of opportunity for different interpretations as to what the heck it means.
Everything's changed drastically on that. Originally, there was going to be 36 sites and a whole commonwealth, and now it's market-driven. They could have 36,000 sites.
Yeah.
It's changed that much, so. The state's seen the revenue enhancement there, and they don't care how many there are. They just want to grab the money now.
All right, so the last one is on page 19. At the bottom of page 19, the petitioned article number 26. We always have, or we frequently have our petition articles as the last article of the evening. This is a non-binding resolution that addresses money in political campaigns. So it was submitted with 12 signatures, which exceeds the minimum requirement. It is on the ballot as on the warrant. there you go.
Are we going to have the petitioners in at all prior to the town meeting to discuss the article? Or?
I invited them in for tonight's meeting, and I don't see them here.
All right. Okay. So that's it. Anything on the warrant articles for the time being? We're just going to keep rolling through these meeting to meeting so we make sure we don't lose anything. If not, we'll roll into the regular agenda. Yep. So first order of business would be the consent agenda. And the consent agenda this evening, we have no consent agenda.
Warrant.
It's
just
warrant.
One warrant.
Oh, there it is. I'm sorry. Yep.
Oh, motion to accept.
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. And then for old business awarding the senior center RFQ, David or Jane? Who's
so we last time you met, you agreed to the ranking of the three finalists presented by the senior center building committee for the architectural services for the new senior center. You authorized them to negotiate. This afternoon, we received a negotiated price of $400,000 for the design of the senior center. That equates to 7.5% of the original appropriation. So that's a very reasonable price. Make a recommendation that you'll make that award.
Motion accept.
Second.
Second on that?
Second.
Okay, any questions or discussion on that?
Hey, would you like to have any comments regarding that? Or?
Thank you.
You're comfortable? Okay. All right, all in favor?
Aye, aye, aye.
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 And then the same for the fire substation, David.
All right, same process has had to do with the fire substation. Contractor, the designer submitted a price of $195,000, which works out to 6.6% of the original appropriation. Again, this is a very, very reasonable price, and so I make a recommendation.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, and any questions or discussion on the RFQ? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you, Jane.
Thank you.
Okay, so next on the agenda we have the use of the town commons policy.
Yeah, so we have a policy for the use of the town commons. A question came up as to if an event that was planned is not working out the way that they would like it, can they get their money back? So we did a little bit of research. We talked to private and public venues, and the recommendation came back is that we adopt a 60-day cancellation policy. So 60 days before an event, if somebody cancels, they can get their money back, a $500 fee for the use of the common.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded. Any questions, discussion?
Yeah, regarding this guidelines and application for use of the common,
yeah.
Has this been adopted? Did we adopt this, and who did it?
Yes, you adopted this many years ago.
I hate that.
Okay.
I
what do you hate?
Well, let's vote on what's on the table, and then I'll point out some of the things that on that agreement that I completely disagree with.
Okay. You want more time to read over it?
No, I'll tell you exactly what afterwards.
Okay. All right, so motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, Jared?
I'm very disappointed that this would ever be signed in the way that it says there, with structures not being used. We've made our comments so it's virtually impossible to allow for monuments. I mean, when you tell somebody that the placing seating on a common detracts from the common itself, I think that's wrong. I think that there should be seating on the common. I think trash should be picked up on the common. And if we wanted to ever put a memorial park in the town of Hadley, I would hope that the common would be a place that we could look at it. Based on the information here on this outline here, that there could never have that allowed there. We're allowed to have functions there, and that's great, and I appreciate those. But I think we've taken our common and put the Palisades back up so that we virtually can't use it. I mean, if somebody wanted to come forward and say that, you know, we want to put a music set up very similar to the way South Hadley has theirs, where they have concerts on the common.
Gazebo there, yeah. Or whatever.
We're looking at a document here that says that we absolutely cannot do that.
Well,
I bet your historical commission has.
That's why I asked who yeah. You know.
Yeah. You know, you got the water fountain and picnic tables and everything on the other side by the bike path. Look.
Again, anything we could do, we have the nicest common in New England, and we constantly put things in it to keep people off of the nicest common in New England. As far as seating and trash receptacles and things like that go, and never have the opportunity to be able to place, like I said, a monument park there for our veterans, or to put something like out there like a venue for listening to music, because we have this document here that says we can't, I think is wrong.
So what's the action item then? I mean, it seems like somebody should go back and take ownership of looking into this, go back to the Historical Commission, ask for their input.
Let's just find out, you know, when this was adopted and why it was adopted.
So you're saying we no longer can have concerts there if somebody plans one?
You can, but you cannot put a stadium. You can't put
a permanent structure. Yeah, because
there.
We used to have those big band concerts by, you know, the arts festival people and stuff years ago. They were tremendous.
In summary, it says the following does not contribute to the preservation of the common: benches or trash receptacles. What does somebody do with the trash? And if we don't have benches there for people to sit and enjoy the common, that's not very good. Foundations or any plantings, including trees and shrubs, permanent structures, including but not limited to memorials, monuments, recreational facilities, displays, or signage. The parking, I understand. But I just think this takes away from the use of a beautiful common in New England.
So why don't we find out when it was adopted, who was involved, and then we can decide if anybody wants to go off and come up with a...
I can tell you that this was already in place when I came on board in 2005.
Yeah, it references 2005 study, so that would be the earliest.
I sort of agree with you, Jerry. I know South Hadley has a gazebo on theirs, and every Thursday during the summer they have concerts on it.
Yeah,
and people bring chairs and sit.
But it's not the common that we have.
Yeah,
all
it is. That's true.
All they have is like the center of East Hampton. It's just a gazebo.
Exactly, yeah.
It's not a common. It's
we have the
true
South Hadley's
common.
The mile all the way around it, we have.
That's what makes it.
And it would still be that if we didn't have roads going through it.
We used to have benches and things at the front with the water fountain.
Mm-hmm. So why don't we get more information, and then it sounds like people want to talk about it, so that we can put it on a subsequent agenda and figure out what to do with it.
And I think they took a lot of this into consideration for the residents of the town common too, that live, you know, that bought it, that their homes have been there for years. I think they had a lot to do of what they actually wanted to have on the town common too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they bought their piece of property for a specific reason, for what's there, you know.
Commons are for everyone to use. It's the reason that you have them.
I know.
I'm not looking to, you know, put my sheep out there, but.
We have a plan.
I bet you are.
We have a plan, and we're moving on to the next item, because Joyce wants to go home with this morning. Asparagus Fest. We have Marie Wechter here tonight. Hello, Marie.
Good evening.
Don't you like using the common, Marie?
I love the common.
Is it that time of the year again?
It's that time of the year. God's return to spring. We've submitted our applications again for the use of the common and for a one-day liquor license so that we can hold the 2017 Asparagus Festival again. We appreciate all the changes and the updates in the process, and we've got our application pretty much complete. I submitted the insurance information today,
mm-hmm.
and we've made a request for the deposit. I just want to let you know that upon advice, I met with both chief police, chief of fire, and we had a preliminary meeting to review last year's plan, what went well and what we can modify.
Mm-hmm.
They identified two action items that we'll be working on, issues that we are going to mitigate. One was to make sure that the west side of the street on the west side is kept clear for emergency vehicles.
Yep.
We had some problems with vendors last year. And the other is to make sure that the food vendors that come are completely in compliance and take more of a proactive role to make sure their permitting's in place, rather than, because I think the burden fell to the town last year to make sure the permits were there. So those are the two areas we've been asked to address, and we're putting plans together to address those two things.
We need more vendors too, don't we, for food?
You know, it's a hard one. I'm really trying, but you know, it's really a balance. It's not most food, you know, it's really some part for some restaurants to mount the presence there, because it costs money to come, so they have to have staff and food. So it's really, we're working on that balance. How many food vendors is the right balance? So any advice you guys have?
I guess the only problem I had it with last year, I liked it much better on the north side.
Oh, you did?
Because everybody that comes to your event now has to cross Route 9. They park on the north side, and there's constantly people going back and forth through that traffic, and it looks like an accident waiting to happen. The officers did a tremendous job last year maintaining that, but when you had your activities on the north side, and you had your meal, the big meal that people under the tent on the south side, everything seemed to be working much better. Rocky Hill Road played into it, right?
It may appear that way.
With one exception, Donald, everybody going to the dump was crazy mad. Because that's why I can move to the other side.
Yeah.
The access to the dump on the one day when people were...
Well, maybe they could close the dump for one day.
But also safety issues.
You know, they could live with that, I'm sure.
Unlike other public events in the Valley of recent times, there was no traffic jams, no backlog of traffic, despite the fact that it was a very busy time and that there was construction on Route 9 at the time. The new plan, moving it all to the south side, meant that the traffic can be is the word I'm looking for?
Mitigated?
Yes, sent or pointed when they come off the bridge to Bay Road, so that people, and actually, a lot, most of the people did actually still park on the south side. It just looked like there were a lot of people crossing from the north side. We also had a plan in place for overflow parking to be at Hopkins Academy. So although it looked like a lot of people, because we can't control everyone, we really did a good job last year of getting the bulk of the traffic to people to park on the south side or side streets on the south side of Route 9. So from the feedback from the police and fire departments, that part of it was very successful.
This was their recommendation.
This was their recommendation, and I fought it. I really liked it on the south side.
I looked, I just seen a lot of families pushing strollers across Route 9, and...
You know, we did contract for a full complement of protection last year, so that we would have people there to make sure people cross safely, and we're totally intending to do the same thing this year. So they did a great job. So,
well, you still got your farmers going down to the meadows too. They're at the start of their season too.
So you're looking for approval tonight, clearly subject to
the fact that we continue to work with public safety and fire department
and
Marlowe.
Yeah, so any,
to make sure that everyone's issues are addressed.
Recommend approval subject to any order of conditions.
You're the only one to wait. So moved.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Now I hope you all put the date on your calendars. I know a lot of you had family obligations and travel last year.
Is this earlier than last year?
No, it's the same day. We have to sandwich it in after the graduations at the major universities, because those are huge traffic issues for the town, and then while there's still some asparagus, so.
The Memorial Day weekend is peak weekend for asparagus. You're dead on with the state.
Yeah.
It's just last year was a tough year.
Yeah. Well, we're hoping for a good year, so thank you all very much.
Thanks, Marie.
The one-day liquor license. Yeah.
So we have to do them separately?
Yep.
Okay.
So
So motion made and seconded to approve the one-day liquor license for beer and wine at the festival. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Thank you, Marie.
Same events this year? What are the events this
year? Pretty much the same.
Who's cooking?
I'm not 100% sure who the six chefs are. I'm not sure yet, but if you want to get involved, we'd love to have you on the committee.
When you're not doing
good talking to you.
Thank you. You walk across the street and eat.
Okay, next on the agenda, we have a request from Jennifer Murphy for the Fall Craft Fair.
Is she here?
Yep, she's right here.
Yep.
Hi, Jennifer.
Hi. I submitted my application for our Fall Craft Fair. We're hoping to have on October 14th. We did two events on the Common last year, one in June, one in October. Both went very well.
A little better weather this year, that's what we need.
We had a tough time in June. It was the last time it rained, and it poured the last time for months after, that it didn't rain. But October was great, maybe a little windy, but so we're just looking for October for this year.
Okay, one more thing.
Well, you're working the details out with the fire and police and DPW.
Yeah. And if memory serves me correctly, last year didn't we have issues where you had concerns about the cleanliness of the common?
Yes. So, I felt like $500 is a lot of money. We're a small organization, so it's a lot of money for us to spend. And it was my understanding that goes towards the upkeep of the common. And I was assured that it would be maintained before cleared before the event. But the day before, when I went to set up, there were sticks and branches and trash, and it hadn't been mowed. There were the leaves everywhere, and so I had to spend an hour or two to clear it out, and so it kind of made me wonder, what's that $500 going towards?
So we actually do clean up the common before each event. We do take a photograph of the fact that we cleaned it up. Apparently, in that particular case, there was a wind event that brought down a lot of sticks and leaves. That happened after the cleanup, but it did occur.
Well, the gentleman that I spoke with,
I understand the whole history about that. We've you were given bad advice as to what exactly had happened, but we will do the same as before, as we will clean up a day or so beforehand.
Not leaves, though, is it? I mean.
We had everything cleaned up 2 days
leaves
before
too?
The event.
Okay.
And
The evening before, I believe she came to check out the common, we had a heck of a wind that night. There were still quite a few trees with a lot of leaves left on them. We were involved in another job. We couldn't get back there and clean it again. So we were just fighting Mother Nature at that point, and on the leaves coming off the trees for the most part. So.
I was mad in my own yard, for God's sakes. Couldn't keep them off the lawn.
Right. So we just want to make sure it goes smoothly, because last year there was a bit of upset around it. So recommendation in terms of...
Mother Nature is still mother, but we will take care of the common, and we will take a photograph of the document.
Okay, you comfortable with that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Motion and a second on the floor.
You started to make a motion? I didn't hear a second.
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded. All in favor of approving?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, good luck. Hope you have good weather.
Good luck this minute.
Yeah. Next, the active shooter plan and the exercise RFP. David, you have an update on this?
Yeah, so this is just a formality that we had an RFP for the active shooter plan and exercise development. This is funded through a grant that we got competitively. I don't think anybody else in the Commonwealth got it. It was $50,000. And we had to bid that out. We only got one bidder back, an outfit called CRA. They're out of Vienna, Virginia. The committee that's evaluating this has determined that this company is qualified to do the work, and so they ask that you accept their ranking of the one company, and then we'll go on with the rest of the RFP process, which involves opening up the price proposal.
Okay.
Is
so
it
that's
usual that you only have one bidder on these things?
It's a little unusual. You cast your nets, you're going fishing, you pull in whatever you pull in.
I mean, if it was one person that bid on it and they were in Massachusetts, I understand, but our one bidder comes from Virginia?
Yeah.
Huh.
But this is the recommendation of the two chiefs?
This is the recommendation of the committee.
So moved.
Oh, there's a committee. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
The only question I have with that is where is it going to take place? Is it going to take place in a school?
Mall. No, at the Hampshire Mall.
Hampshire Mall. Okay, I didn't have any idea. I realize it's going to take care of a lot of communities and a lot of police departments, and it's a good thing. I just wanted to know the location.
Sure.
It's down on this page.
Yeah, it says Pyramid Company.
Under project description.
Yep. Okay. Motion
that was
made.
My first question too.
Seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. Affordable housing project. David, this has to do with the an issue that's been raised by Barry Roberts with the over 55 housing and code.
We're feeling our way along on this one. Back in 2008, the town passed a bylaw having to do with the senior housing overlay district. Part of the requirements of the senior housing overlay district is that a developer offering affordable housing has to get a list of eligible tenants from the Hadley Housing Authority. The Hadley Housing Authority has declined to perform this function, and they have their reasons to do so. They're concerned about liability. They're concerned about staff time. So I've had a conversation with them about this. I've indicated that the liability, there is none for them, and we certainly can put together a waiver form so that they don't have to be concerned. And they're concerned if there are two spots available and they recommend five people, two people get in, the other three might get bad and turn around and sue them. Very low probability, but certainly we can put together the safeguards. Their other concern is that this strains their available staff time, and I pointed out that there's nothing in the bylaw that prevents them from charging a fee for the certification process.
Let's go back to the start of this, where we said that in order for the permit to be issued for this particular location, the planning board has put forth a information that says that they have to be run through the town of Hadley's housing authority?
Yeah.
Not exactly. The way that the language, it refers to the local, which obviously would be the Hadley Housing Authority, but it doesn't preclude it from being another area entity. It's just the clear intent was that it would be the Hadley Housing Authority.
Isn't this just pertaining to the lower rated units solely.
Affordable.
Yeah, the affordable housing, so I would think that would enhance the housing authority, because then Hadley people would have a priority, wouldn't they?
They don't anyways. You can't have a priority of that.
Golden Court still has a, no more, that's been eliminated?
Ever since you've, like, when you took the state money on that, you precluded it from having the availability to prioritize.
That's something I'm not aware of then. I thought it was still a priority item for, you know, people that warranted lower income people in Hadley, they would have a priority.
Is this a bylaw that we're talking about here?
Yes.
Or is this a qualification for the permit to be issued to them?
This is a zoning bylaw under chapter 27.5.8. And you've got a link to that particular section. And the operable part says, the property owner who's developing affordable housing shall seek referrals for the affordable senior units from the Hadley Housing Authority and shall submit an annual report to the Hadley Housing Authority detailing compliance with the affordable senior housing provisions of the senior housing development approval. Since the Hadley Housing Authority is saying we're unable to or concerned about our participation in there, and because this is a zoning bylaw requirement of the planning board, this development is stuck because they can't get the planning board to say yes, because the Hadley Housing Authority is not in right now in a position to say yes either.
No. So there's more to the story.
So I think there's a win-win here. You know, we can certainly address the risk part of it. And again, there's nothing in here that precludes the Hadley Housing Authority saying, well, we need some dollars in order to perform this function.
So, Goldwire called me yesterday. He was hoping to be able to be here tonight, but he had another commitment.
Who's lawyer?
Bill Dwyer, from the planning board. And Bill said one of the other, again, just more information, one of the other thoughts he had was he went back to a bylaw that was put in place years ago, and on town meeting floor it was amended to remove the language that would allow for a workaround on affordable units, because it's actually possible legally for a developer, in lieu of having these affordable units, to make a contribution to an affordable housing trust.
Mm-hmm.
And then those funds would stay self-contained in that trust, and that particular development wouldn't have to build affordable units as long as they were kind of mitigating the impact by putting money into an affordable housing trust that where units could then be, that those funds could be expended elsewhere in town.
Mm-hmm. The second impact though to that is we need to keep our numbers high enough so that affordable housing, one of the fears that they were having is so the 40Bs don't come and get ramrodded down the throats of the town, that we keep our percentages above 10.
So I think what Bill was just saying was that at this point, when he went back and looked at the history on that, it was actually, the language was modified on town meeting floor at the suggestion of the finance committee back then, who were uncomfortable with the creation of this trust. Until further, you know, warranted further investigation. Bill said they never went back and readdressed that. So he's going to work with the planning board to actually go back and look at that as a possibility. It would have to go to town meeting. There would have to be a full explanation as to why we were modifying an existing bylaw. Mr. Roberts may or may not be happy with that as an alternative solution, but I'm just adding to the story because Bill wanted to make sure that we were aware that that's something else that they're discussing that would help the immediate situation.
Would we have enough time to do that for the annual town meeting?
Well, this conversation just took place.
Okay.
I think he just like rattled this around within the past 72 hours, so that's a question for him.
So I would say we don't do anything until we hear back from Mr. Dwyer.
Yeah, I'd like to get the rest of the facts together, you know.
Okay.
Well, if David said it's a possibility to charge a fee structure, why couldn't they charge the fee structure and hire someone to do it for them, the housing authority?
Well, so what happened was, when Barry Roberts went in front of the planning board to express his consternation about this conundrum that was created by the language, the planning board made it clear that this was rip and read out of state proposed language, and they inserted Hadley a housing authority where it said your local action unit or whatever it is in here, and that administratively they didn't have any issue at all with, you know, they have some leeway as a planning board to say, okay, well, if the Hadley Housing Authority can't do it, but you can get the Valley CDC to do it because they have people that do this kind of thing, or HAP housing, we're fine with that. But they told Barry Roberts that they said, you go ahead and you contact the state and find out what other options there are. So Barry was doing additional legwork to see if HAP or Valley CDC, he was reaching out to them, could in fact do it, but it was on his dime to do that. So that's where the kerfuffle is right now.
And to that end, Mr. Roberts has presented to us a local initiative program application for local action units, which he would like you to take action on, and I don't know enough about it to be able to make a recommendation.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like this would be a reasonable thing to do, but is he clear that this is under the purview of the Select Board?
I don't know enough about this in order to say one way or the other.
Yeah, did Barry know we were talking about it tonight?
Yes, he asked. I actually expected him to be here tonight.
Okay.
If you need any help on the Valley CDC, I could help you with that only because I'm on their board.
Excellent. Okay. Yeah, I know he was talking to the Valley CDC. I mean, I'm comfortable with this, but I don't want to, only because I've been in direct contact with.
Can we just continue until we get more information?
Yeah,
for now?
Could we push it to next week?
Sure.
Okay.
Can I ask a question? Did the Housing Authority have any problem with it when we were passing this bylaw?
I went back to the submittal by the town clerk to the attorney general, for any zoning bylaw, it has to be approved by the attorney general before that. I read the legal opinion of their scrutiny. There was no jurisdictional issues raised by the attorney general, so the bylaw as is legal. There's no state law impeding this from moving forward.
I think, just from my standpoint, want to do everything we can within our legal bounds to keep the over 55 housing project moving. I think that's, you know, we want to be very supportive of this development, but it probably would also make sense.
How long ago was it brought up to the Housing Authority?
Oh. It was this year, wasn't it?
Just
this
year? Oh, so it's fresh in our minds. Yeah.
When was the bylaw passed?
2008.
So can we also run this document by the planning board?
Sure.
Send it to Mr. Dwyer or Maximoski
or something? Be happy to do that. Jerry, you raised a concern about the 10% threshold. We're at 13% right now.
It's great, but I don't want to start changing bylaws. I think the planning board does a great job making sure we don't have to worry about this, and we should do everything to support it and make sure that what they've negotiated gets done. But I'll tell you, Mr. Roberts is, you know, if he's getting held up on this project, I don't think that's fair to him either.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. Plus plan, so we'll defer it, and then we'll hopefully be able to vote on this on Wednesday next.
Right.
Okay. Okay. And then we have the agreement for engineering services on the geotech assessment of the levee system.
We have a contractor who's going to do the subsurface exploration of our dike. We've agreed upon a price. They've signed their side of the contract, and so I ask the board to authorize the signing of the contract on behalf of the
town.
Been
reviewed by our attorney?
Yep.
Make a motion, accept.
Second.
And sign.
Motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Then I think the only other thing we had was the town administrator report. I did skip over that because I know we have an executive session tonight. Are there any highlights you want to point out?
Um,
Joyce wants to know about Bay Road.
No, I don't.
Still there.
It's still there.
Hasn't fallen in.
Some days are better than others.
All right, so I'm just going to run through this very briefly and just the changes from the previous week. Public safety roof update, you're going to start on May 1st.
I thought it was April when I moved it to May, huh?
The April is for the bridge.
Yes.
Okay.
Project straight, Joyce.
Okay, we just handled the designer selection for the senior center and the fire substation. We submitted testimony to the Massachusetts Department of Public Utilities having to do with the gas moratorium. We submitted that today, so that was taken into account with many other requests for lifting the gas moratorium. We got the code for the Commonwealth Compact IT grant. We'll be writing that tomorrow. We'll present that to the Select Board as a first deadline. Be asking for the implementation of years 3, 4, and 5 of the 5-year strategic plan, as well as the SCADA system for the wastewater treatment system. Town meeting, we've got to continue to work on that. Sewer clarifier update, the bids became active today. We have sub-bids that are due in 2 weeks, and general bids are due on April 5th, so hopefully that's all set. We did receive the State Revolving Fund Loan Program grant for the stormwater project. We're looking at the terms of the loan to make sure that it makes sense for us. And the OPEB actuarial, we're working with the auditors to review the requirements under GASB 75 to see if early adoption of that process makes sense for us or hurts us.
Okay, any questions for David?
Yeah, do you want to continue with the SRF on the water impact? I mean, do we want to find out any information as to whether or not that is still a priority?
The SRF for the Route 9 project?
No, for the water, the one you just spoke of.
Oh, the was yeah, so the stormwater.
Stormwater, I'm
yeah,
sorry.
So it's a 10-year permit, but a 20-year loan, so we're not quite sure if that makes sense for us, so we want to take a look at those requirements.
We request to find out if it's still a priority. I think that was being looked at as to whether or not that was going to be a priority with the new administration.
The EPA, so the federal the United States Environmental Protection Agency looks like they're going to go through a little bit of a rocky time. The Massachusetts Department of Public Utilities signed on as co-administrators of the MS4 stormwater permit. So we are not off the hook because if the EPA's, let's say the funding is cut to zero, we still have the Massachusetts DEP to that will require us to jump through all the hoops of the MS4. So.
Okay.
Sorry, I can't give you any good news on that score. It's still an unfunded mandate.
Okay, anything else for David? If not, then before we go into executive session, we have, do we have any announcements?
I just have a question. I want to see if the board will support a Hadley cleanup day again, like we had last year and sponsored by the board.
Do you have a date in mind?
No, that's... At this point, we'd like to do it a lot quicker than May because the grass was growing and it was hard to pull the trash out of it.
Mm-hmm.
But there's really no cost. We have the banner this year. We have garbage bags down the highway department. So it's just getting people out and advertising it.
Okay.
Minimal cost.
Anybody have any thoughts about that?
No problems with that at all. I support it.
Yep. I'm fine with it. I think it's a good idea. Joyce?
Sure.
John, you guys okay?
Yeah. That's
okay.
Fine.
Without notices to the
we'll come back with a date. I'll talk to Marlo, try to find out would it be a good time to do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
You have our support.
So yeah, you've supported us last year and you've got everything down the highway garage was left there, so it'd be easy to do this year.
Sure.
Thank you.
Good. Thank you. Anybody else? David?
Do you? I'll defer to you first. Okay. I just
wanted
to point out to anybody who's watching that probably
have noticed that we refer to the computer screen a lot in order to access various documents, applications, budgets, warrants, et cetera. All of this is available online. If you look at the posting for the Select Board, there's instructions for online agendas, and you can access all these wonderful documents that we're talking so much about this. And so we really want the town of Hadley to be transparent. And so this is an opportunity for people who are maybe watching from the comfort of their homes to follow the fine-grained detail of what we're talking about.
Is that the part that you wanted me to mention at the beginning of every meeting that I forgot about already?
I'm having hazy on that one.
All right, thank you for remembering.
One last thing.
Yeah.
I'd like to compliment our town collector. I was in her office, and she always says, everybody's coming in and complaining about why our tax bills are so high to her. And she put up a sign, and she says, why don't you just look at the sign? And it shows Hadley at 1157 for fiscal 2017, Shutesbury going all the way up to 2276. And the closest to us is Hatfield at 1322. But I thought it was a novel idea on her part. She says, as soon as they look at the sign, they quiet right down.
Thank you, Sue. We know you're watching.
Yeah.
Okay, Joyce?
You're going to do the one about
retirement? Komosky? Retirement party?
We could. Just an update for Mr. Komosky. His retirement party is April 1st. It's going to be at the American Legion. Tickets are available here at the Town Hall, American Legion, and a couple other places, the clubs in town. And it's $20 a ticket. It includes his gift, and it'll be a sit-down dinner and a dance. So it should be a nice evening to show our appreciation to Mike's 42 years of service for the town of Hadley.
Sounds good. Joyce?
And then ending the night, we have three residents that have passed away. We have Sophie Matusko. Condolences to her family, to the family of Catherine Walkus, and to the family of Peter Krutov. We send our condolences also.
Okay. And on a little bit more positive note, I'd like to congratulate Miss Allie Jenks, who was highlighted in the Daily Hampshire Gazette as it's the first year that they have done a Youth Leadership Award. So congratulations to Allie and to her family. Excellent job. Nice job representing our town.
And good luck to our boys basketball team.
Saturday, 12:30, the cage.
12:30? Okay.
Semifinals.
Saturday, 12:30, boys basketball.
Yep.
Okay. All right. So.
Motion adjourned.
Motion to go into executive session.
Oh, that's right.
Okay.
Not to reconvene in open session.
Okay. So do you want to read the language?
Sure. Is it in here?
Yep. All the way down.
There we go.
There you go.
All right, the Select Board will enter into executive session as per the provisions of ML Chapter 30A, Section 21A, to discuss the reputation, character, physical condition, or mental health, rather than professional competence of an individual, or to discuss the discipline or dismissal of or complaints or charges brought against a public officer, employee, staff member, or individual as being a Select Board member.
Yeah, okay. Oh, and as chair, I recognize the fact that having this discussion in open session may have a detrimental impact to the town.
Is there a second?
There is.
Okay.
Roll call vote. Paczynski?
No.
Chunglo?
Yes.
Keegan?
Yes.
Divine?
Yes.
Waskevitz?
Yes.
I guess at this time, my attorney for my ethics case is on vacation, and I was going to ask him if I should be involved in this because it's so similar, and the attorney made the recommendation to go to the ethics that did the town's case against me. So I think I'm going to recuse myself from any discussion on this, because I can't talk to him in an adequate time, and just for a safeguard, I'm going to recuse myself.
Fair enough.
All right, fair enough, Donald. Okay.
All right, we're done. Okay.